doesn't feel like you can hear me. Well, we're glad that you've come to Countryside today to help us praise and worship God. For any of you who are visiting this morning, we hope you will feel very welcome and come back soon so you can be part of our church family. It's a lovely morning with fall just on the horizon, and thankfully the really hot summer temperatures are gone for good. Now please sit quietly and listen to what God might be saying to you through the music the bells play for our prelude, Freely, Freely.
Thank you.
glad that that's over. That was a hard one. All right, please join me in reading the call to worship, which is printed in your bulletin. We gather together in praise and worship of our faithful God, because our help and our hope rests always in the Lord our God.
We bring our praises and thankful responses to our saving God.
Blessed be the Lord our God, who is our security and home, and whose mercy and grace free us from all that traps us.
Blessings, brethren, honor, and glory.
Blessed be the, let's see.
We
come together to praise and worship our all-powerful God because we are confident of God's generous care over us. Our eternal trust is in the name of the Lord our God, who is our maker, our savior, and our timeless home. Amen. Please join me in singing number 461, verses 1, 2, and 4. Lord, whose love through humble service. Join others on our walk of faith, where we strive to know you better and to live more like you want us to live. Every day we are reminded of your generosity, for we are truly best blessed way beyond our deserving, not only materially, but in being able to come and freely worship anytime we want. We thank you for Roger and Trudy and their ministry here at Countryside. Thanks to Gabe and Lavella and Bill for their tireless ministry. Thank you for the others who care for our building and to be sure that the services go well and who serve behind the scenes so we can be a beacon in our neighborhood and in our hurting world. Praise God for our Child Development Center, where parents know that their babies and little children are learning and growing in a safe setting while their parents are at work. Please continue to bless that ministry. We ask you to calm our racing minds so that we can hear your still small voice amid all the clamor of the world outside these walls. Lord, we need you to guide us through our daily lives because there are so many temptations hitting us from every direction. Let us lean on you for everything. May we remember to let go of our worries and let you show us how to solve them. And may we not take the worries back. You are an awesome God, and we are forever grateful that you sent us your Son to show us the way to live eternally with you and with our loved ones. And now let us join our voices in saying the prayer that he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Didn't hear what Trudy said to me, and I don't know that I'm going to repeat it. She said this may be the last day she could come up here and say that she is young because tomorrow is her birthday. Okay, so if you see me wearing a t-shirt like this or a shirt like this, what do you think I may be? Well, I know it's too small. I know that it's too small. I didn't mean that. I meant the shirt itself, not the size. Use your imagination, okay? What, I might be a Chiefs fan, right? Or I like Patrick Mahomes. Yeah, well, there's a good possibility that I would be a Chiefs fan if I wear this, right? Now, what if I go to a Chiefs game wearing a shirt like this, and they're like, Monday night they play Denver, right? What if I stand up and all of a sudden start yelling for the Broncos? Am I really a Chiefs fan? I would have some angry people, yeah, wearing this shirt. Well, not this shirt, but one that fit me. Yeah, they probably would. But what if I go to a Chiefs game and instead of having on a shirt like this, I have on just a plain white t-shirt? Can I still be a Chiefs fan? Sure. Okay, so in our scripture reading for today, we hear people that are doing things that are not part of the original 12 apostles. And John chastises them for that, and he wants them to stop. And Jesus says to him, those who are with us are not against us. So just because I may not have on a Chiefs fan shirt, I may very well be a Chiefs fan. So what we need to learn from this is, how should we judge other people, or how should we treat other people? By the way they're dressed, or by what they say and what they do? It's by what they say and what they do, not how they dress, okay? So just remember those words of Jesus. If they are not against us, they are for us. So remember that this week. And hopefully the Chiefs will win this week. See you guys later. And thank you for the use of your shirt. This is her shirt, not mine.
I just want to bring to your attention that there is a prayer quilt in the narthex, and we'd like you all to stop by and tie a knot and say a prayer for Celia Johnson. She and Carl are former members here. Tina Evans has requested that for her. And also, this Friday is First Friday, so bring a friend. It's always fun, and there's always prizes and good fellowship, so. We're having ham and potato casserole, so that'll be yummy. And then also on October the 14th, come hungry to church, because right after church, the Disciple Women's Fellowship will be having a luncheon downstairs as a fundraiser for their scholarships for the upcoming year. It will be right after church, and it'll be chicken and noodles. So come hungry and prepare to stay. And then Carl Hohn would like to thank everybody for the plastic bags that you are bringing, the empty pop cans, and also any non-perishable food items that you have brought or will bring. And I think that's it. So let's sing the hymn number 578, I Need Thee Every Hour, verses 1 and 3.
As we come to our prayer time this morning, we want to remember Lee Lowry. He is in the rehab part of the place where he lives, which I guess is still part of Bickford Place, as far as I know. Yes? Okay. So Lee is in, and I believe, room 302, I think that is correct. So we need to keep Lee in our prayers. He is still having issues with his right leg, it not being strong enough to support him. So for continued strength and healing for Lee, O Lord, hear our prayers. Cameron did have his surgery on Friday, and they were not able to do it laparoscopically. They had to do it the old-fashioned way. My understanding is that he was being transferred into a regular room sometime this morning. So for continued healing for Cameron, O Lord, hear our prayers. Annette shared with me that she worked 20 hours this past week. And that she will be beginning PT as well as work starting on Monday. So for continued strength for Annette, O Lord, hear our prayers. Are there other prayer concerns? Yes, Barb.
Does Jackson have a baby brother or sister yet?
No. But We do need to keep Megan in our prayers. Javon, when is she due?
October 29th.
October 29th, but maybe a couple of weeks early. Okay. So for safety for Megan and the baby, and for peace and comfort, oh Lord, hear our prayers. The group that Paul and Gabe and I sing, and I'm not singing with them this fall, but that is directed by a gentleman named Kirk Carson. And this past week, he lost his son. So we need to keep that family in our prayers. So for comfort for the Carson family as they mourn, oh Lord, hear our prayers. Other prayer concerns from you this morning? Yes, ma'am. What is her name?
Iris.
Iris? So for Iris, as she recovers from a broken shoulder and arm on the same side.
Oh Lord, hear our prayers.
Join me now as we pray together. Gracious and loving God, we do thank you for this time, this day that you give us to come into your house and to worship you and to cast all of our cares on you. Gracious God, be with those who are mourning today. Comfort them. Be with those who are recovering from surgeries. Give them strength and healing. Gracious God, we do thank you so much for the ability to come to you in prayer. Help us to listen for that still small voice that responds when we pray. We thank you for your presence here with us this morning. Open our hearts. Help us to hear your words. Help us to learn from your words. Help us to learn what Jesus means when he really says those who are for us are not against us. We ask these things humbly now in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Turn with me, if you would, in your Bibles to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 38 through 50. While you are turning there, here's my college football report from yesterday. Listen closely. Oh, somewhere in this favored land, the sun is shining bright. The band is playing somewhere, and somewhere hearts are light. And somewhere men are laughing, and somewhere children shout. But there's no joy in Mudville. Mighty K-State, KU, and South Carolina have struck out. That's not an original poem, in case you didn't know that. How many of you had to memorize that when you were in high school? Yeah, we did. That was one that we had to memorize. That's great. Hear God's word from Mark, chapter 9, beginning with verse 38. John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell the fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom with one eye than to have 2 eyes and be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." So ends the reading of God's word. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart be holy and acceptable to you. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Now, most of us don't want to die and leave all our stuff or our mess for our children to clean up. And yet sometimes death comes unexpectedly, and we don't have time to declutter things, leaving behind lots of stuff to either be kept by the next generation or thrown away. The Swedish people have a word, dostanding, meaning death cleaning. In our scripture reading for today, Jesus challenges us to perform a sort of spiritual death cleaning, removing from our lives sinful actions and attitudes that cause us to stumble or that could possibly cause someone else to stumble. Jesus challenges each one of us to do a kind of death cleaning by removing from our lives the sinful actions and attitudes that cause us to stumble. In the town of Capernaum, John, one of the three inner circle of disciples, complains to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." John is concerned that this unknown exorcist is not properly trained or authorized to use the name of Jesus in his healing work. But Jesus responds by simply saying, "Don't stop him, for no one does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us." You ever been in a situation like this? You see someone doing something that you think is improper because maybe they don't have the proper credentials, or they don't have that right piece of sheepskin hanging on a wall somewhere. And you know that you can just do what they're doing better. whoever is not against us is for us. That still hasn't changed yet today. Today we need a kind of death cleaning at a time in which so many people are obsessed with purity in religion or politics or other things. Former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, who was Secretary of State under the George W. Bush administration, has hosted a documentary calling American Creed, which explores the divisions that exist in our country. She is quoted as saying, "We are purist about so many things today, whether it is gay rights or gun rights, and unfortunately, we are attacking each other in a variety of ways. Our nation is seriously divided. We all have to start listening to each other," she continues. "And right now we are shouting at each other instead. Right now we are saying, my grievance, my narrative is superior to yours. I have suffered more. I have been discriminated against more." But unfortunately, things are getting worse. But fortunately, Ms. Rice has found a few Americans who are taking the opposite tack, are putting aside purity in order to unify their communities. Jesus would heartily approve of this because he is always looking to unite instead of divide. Whoever is not against us is for us. The call to this death cleaning continues when Jesus says, "If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off." That's a harsh thing. That is a harsh thing. But he says, "It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off as well. It is better to enter life lame and have 2 feet than to be thrown into hell." In these verses, this phrase, "causes you to stumble," is a translation of the Greek word scandalizo, which carries over into English with the word scandalize. Jesus is saying that if your hands or feet scandalize you, causing you to sin or to trip you up, stop using your hands and feet in this way. Now you be right about now, you may be wondering how your hands and feet can do anything that is even close to scandalous. Well, most of us use our hands to do our jobs in one way or another, from computer work to construction projects and so on. But sometimes some types of work are more helpful and harmful than others. Maybe your work puts a burden on the poor. Maybe it is harmful to the environment. Maybe what we do with our hands, such as rob a bank, scandalizes our families and destroys our well-being. If that is the case, Jesus says, cut it off, get rid of it. And don't stop there. Replace it with work that is healthier and more productive. At the same time, most of us use our feet to take us to a variety of places, but there are some places to which we really shouldn't go because there are places that do damage to our bodies, to our souls, and certainly to our relationships. Alcoholics are scandalized by bars. Gambling addicts are scandalized by casinos and so on. And in this case, Jesus says, cut off your feet. Now, not literally, of course, but use your feet to take you to places that are good for you, to people who are good for you. The first step in the 12-step program of Alcoholics Anonymous says there are 3 things that you must replace: your play places, your playmates, and your playthings. Be careful, little feet, where you go. But just as Jesus usually does, he takes this a step further when he is quoted as saying, "And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to be in the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and be thrown into hell where the worm never dies, the fire is never quenched." We live in a visually cultural world with tantalizing images all around us. Temptations appear on our computer screens, our smartphones, our television,
and even in the pages of magazines. Perhaps our eyes are drawn to designer fashions, luxury cars, social media postings, or even pornography. If these images scandalize you, get rid of them. Pluck them out. Don't let the things you see cause you to stumble. The point Jesus is making here is that we are supposed to cut off certain behaviors, not body parts. However, that's not exactly what a young man named Aaron Ralston did. Perhaps you remember him from the news or the movie 127 Hours, in which the then 27-year-old Ralston found himself trapped in a canyon with his right arm pinned by a boulder against a rock wall. He had only a little bit of water, two burritos, and a few chunks of chocolate, knowing that he would surely die. He finally used his small knife to cut off his arm and escape. The movie is based on a true story, and it begins by depicting Ralston as an overconfident loner who believed that he was invincible. Any of you have teenage grandchildren or children that just think they are invincible? Well, guess what? They're not. However, the canyon experience changed him, and it changed him for the better. Although he lost his arm, he gained the knowledge that he was kept alive by the love of others, by his relationships with family and friends, and by his dependence on them. Looking back, he is quoted as saying that through the experience, he realized, "Well, God, I love, and love is what kept me alive, and that love is what got me out of that canyon." Death cleaning is important because otherwise we hang on to sinful attitudes and actions that scandalize us and cause us to stumble. Unless we delete these aspects of our lives, we might never discover that God really is love, and that it is truly love that keeps us alive. Sometimes we have to go through trauma to be changed for the better, as Ralston discovered, and sometimes we have to make difficult changes in what we do, where we go, and what we see. Jesus knows these changes are not easy. In fact, he is quoted as saying, "Everyone will be salted with fire," which sounds like a terribly painful experience to me. You ever rubbed or gotten salt in a cut place on your hand? It burns. But know this. In the ancient world, both salt and fire were used as preservatives for food. They were essential to keeping people alive and healthy. So to be salted with fire is to be preserved as a faithful disciple, which leads Jesus to say to his followers and to you and me this morning, have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. And just a little side note here, in biblical times, salt was so important that it was actually used as a form of money. Lots of times, soldiers, especially soldiers, were paid in salt. In closing this morning, what kind of death cleaning do you need to do? Now, I will say this. Since Trudy and I have been married, we have moved 4 times, and there are still at least 2 boxes downstairs in our junk room that have never been opened or unpacked from the very first time we moved. Maybe we should stop moving those boxes. And I would bet that most of you could go through your house and get rid of lots of minutiae or stuff. But that's not what I'm talking about here. I'm talking about other things that may be bothering you. What is it that is keeping you from being a happy tree, like I talked about last week? Has someone offended you and not made any attempt whatsoever to make things right? Forgive them anyway. Has someone hurt you in some way? Forgive them anyway. Has someone belittled you or embarrassed you in public? Forgive them anyway. Or maybe you have caused someone pain or embarrassment or hurt. Take the time to go to them and apologize and make things right. This morning, in a world of abundant distraction and temptations, We need to do the kind of death cleaning that Jesus recommends. It keeps us alive. It keeps us at peace with one another. It keeps us in touch, close touch, with God, who loves us and saves us from the world and from every kind of trouble. May it be so. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, help us to do this cleaning out of all the minutiae in our lives that keep us from being in that right relationship with you and with each other. Help us to truly understand what you mean when you say, those who are with us are not against us. Amen.
Will the deacons please come forward? I'd like everyone to close your eyes for just a minute and think about all of the gifts you have enjoyed so far this very morning. What popped into your mind? Perhaps you thought about how good it felt to wake up and to get out of bed, even if you had a pain here or there. Or maybe you enjoyed the warmth coming from your furnace and the fact that you had a home or apartment to call your own. Were you mindful of what a privilege it was to be able to pray to God before you ate your breakfast? Or maybe you enjoyed reading your Bible before you headed to church and that you were even free to come. And did you think of your family and praise God for them? Now let's think of all the gifts we are free to give back to God. Do you sing? Can you teach a Sunday school class? Can you sew in the quilt ministry? Can you make a visit or call to check on any of the many homebound countrysiders? Are you a good listener? Our offering every Sunday is to collect money, but God needs us to offer ourselves to others every single day. Let us be open to seeing those in need and to stepping up to what God has created us each to do. Now let us honor God with the very best of our lives, our tithes, and our offerings.
Thank you.
Gracious God, we thank you for these gifts given this morning from our hearts. Help us, your children, to take these gifts and use them for your kingdom right here, right now. Bless both the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name.
We prepare for communion by singing together, remembering that everyone is invited here to God's table.
When I was little, our dining, not dining room, our kitchen table bumped up against the wall that became my bedroom about this far up in a split level. And I'd get a knock, 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 which meant bring yourself down here now. Now we get a 5-minute warning notice. It's supper will be on in 5 minutes. And that means close the computer down, go wash your hands, get to the table. Everybody has their own way of being called to the table. And this morning we're called to the table to share in this supper that Jesus had with his disciples and we carry forth to this day. So whether you are called by a bell or by a holler or by a tapping or just a verbal dinner's ready, the Lord calls us today. Come to the table. Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, as she has come to this table, you know our hearts. You also know our concerns and fears and worries about worldly things, but we ask that for just this moment, set them aside. And let us come and celebrate in an end of remembrance a life that changed this whole world and gave us eternal hope and a second chance to be with you in your glory. May these emblems not be taken casually, but earnestly. But they do represent the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May we be with you this day and every day, knowing that you are always with us. And let us live our lives in your glory and make them count. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
We are the Christian Church, disciples of Christ, a movement for wholeness in a fragmented world. As part of the one body of Christ, all are welcome at this table, as God has welcomed us. For it was on that night so long ago when Jesus gave himself up for you, for me. He took bread, he blessed it, and he broke it. He said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the meal, he took the cup, the third cup, the cup of redemption. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood poured out just for you. Drink from it, all of you. For as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim his death until he comes once again."
Would you join me in our prayer of dedication? We love you, gracious God, because you have first loved us. About Christ's table, we know this afresh. Help us to love you with our whole hearts and our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. You may be here this morning having never accepted Christ as your Savior. You may be here seeking a new church home. I would invite you to come as we stand and sing our hymn of dedication, Holy Spirit, Truth Divine, page 241. We'll sing verses 1 and 5. We certainly need to keep Gary in our prayers. And the other one is Celia, the lady that we're doing the prayer quilt for. She is having some very serious, life-threatening heart issues. So we certainly need to keep Celia in our prayers as well. And now, what Barb said about how we were called to dinner. Growing up, I grew up on a small farm, and my grandfather had a bell that had been in his family for over 100 years. A pretty good sized bell, about this big around, about this high. And his wife, my grandmother, that died when I was 2 years old, used that bell to call the family in from the field for lunch. No, that's not right. Deep South, for dinner and supper. We didn't eat lunch. We ate dinner and then supper. And so not long after my grandmother died, that bell was moved to my aunt's house, which was literally right next door to our house. She was the oldest of the four children, and she decided it belonged to her, and it was her job to do that. When my grandfather died, there was a huge family fight between two sisters over that bell. And one night, during the middle of the night, that bell just disappeared. Not saying I had to do anything with that, but I know where that bell is today. That bell now is in my cousin's front yard, so it's in a good place. But that bell was really important growing up as a child. So with that said, let's close in prayer. Gracious God, we do thank you for this beautiful passage of scripture that you give us that sounds horrible, that you tell us to cut off our hands and our feet and pluck out our eyes. But what you really mean is to just get them in the right place, doing the right things. Help us to clean out all the clutter in our lives that keeps us from using our hands, our feet, our eyes, our voice in a way that would be pleasing to you. Watch over us as we part and go our separate ways. Now keep us safe above all this week. Help each one of us to live our lives in such a way that other people will truly see you in us. All God's people said, amen.